Hello and welcome to Business on the Wire. As the economy begins to find its way out of the pandemic, many sectors and verticals would have borne the brunt of what COVID had to throw at us. Several of them are perhaps not large contributors to the GDP, but they are indeed extremely important caches of employment. They're almost the nerves that run through the body of the country. Tourism, hospitality, restaurants have all been impacted very, very hard. But there's one unsung property that has still gone unnoticed: the performing arts community. With theatres almost shut and live performances at this point seeming like they're completely out of the ordinary, what is the future both for performing artist organisations and indeed for the artists themselves? Joining me to talk about that is the woman who has probably sampled and been part of every length and breadth of the performing arts world. Malika Sarabhai, who's a dancer, choreographer, publisher, artist, actor and an activist as well.
Thank you so much for joining in and speaking to me, Ms. Sarabhai. You know, I want to start with a new baby or a new project that you have, Dance Unlocked. Tell me how it came to happen and tell me why that thought was born in your head and your heart.
When the lockdown happened, there were only two people on the campus, me in my apartment here and the artistic director of Darpana across the garden where he lives. And we were just thinking and we were saying, you know, exactly what you and I were saying, that this is really a time of reflection and trying to rethink one's realities. And one of the things about India that bothers me tremendously, and I see it more in India than anywhere else, is that the competitiveness within an occupation, whether it's the competitiveness of architects or doctors, there is very little feeling of sorority or fraternity. And I thought, this has to be changed. So we thought of a video where dancers who never get onto the same platform can get onto the same platform, open up to others, and become a sorority and fraternity. There isn't a gender neutral word for that, incidentally. So you have to say sorority and fraternity, which is stupid. We need to concoct a word. So I just wrote to 22 dancers. I wrote to 25. Shamak Davar's mother was very sick, so he couldn't do it. Two others said they couldn't, but otherwise the generosity with which people said yes was extraordinary, because I said nothing to them. I just gave them the idea and I said, I'll send you the music. Not a single person, Mitali, asked me who else is on it, which is usually the first question. You know, are there people of my level or not? Or is it infradig? Exactly. It was amazing. It was also very funny because most of them had actually never used a phone to film themselves. Alarmel Valli, for instance, had to say no because she just couldn't manage the technology. And she was completely alone. She tried two or three times and then said, I'm sorry, I just can't manage this. But otherwise, Yadavan was constantly giving them instructions, move the phone this side, make it horizontal, make it vertical, go away from it. And many of them were really good sports and did it three or four times because we felt that the camera angles needed to be changed, or an arch in their home was really where they should be and things like that. But It was lovely, and it created this feeling of great togetherness. And Tanmay Bose, this is a piece of music I have loved, and I just picked up the phone and I said, Tanmay, can I take it? And he said, yes, of course you can take it. So, you know, the generosity of people came out, and that was a very warm feeling.
It sounds fantastic.
And it was fun.
I mean, you're right. We're all learning to sort of live our lives through a camera lens. I think it's happening across professions. You know, I was reading an interview you gave about the same project, and you said, we don't know what the future is going to be like and when there will be classes and programs, both for your dance institute and the auditorium. I know we're halfway past this year, but tell me what you're feeling like about the future, the next couple of months, the next year even.
I don't think anything is going to open up. I think we have not seen anything like the worst of this pandemic. And the way people are taking it casually, the way the face mask has become a neck accessory or an ear accessory. You know, and every day there are new things coming up. So we've got to reinvent ourselves. But the biggest problem is so much of performance is being put free on the internet. And yet people have to live. We have salaries to pay. We have establishments. People have to run homes. And when we talk, for instance, if I talk about my going out to do a performances, there are 6 or 7 people with me and their families who are eating off that income. Yeah. Or for instance, there are musicians and music makers. There are instrument makers. There are all these ancillary things like the dhobi, for instance, who irons are very complex costumes. So you're not only talking of performing arts, you are talking like in the film industry of lots and lots of layers. They're the jewelry makers. They're the people who weave the saris that we make into our costumes, which are usually very expensive saris. So, you know, it's a big deal for the weaver. And I think that we have to find a way of monetizing. And somehow, in spite of the fact that most people have been able to survive the lockdown because of the arts, whether it's cinema or whether it's music or whether it's dancing or it's theater that you've been watching, and yet nobody is willing to say, let us support this industry. Well, and I think unless we find a way of monetizing our work and of creating a new genre of video work that is not documentation. We need to think beyond documentation. We need to say, okay, we have this medium and we have real performers. So what can we do to create a genre that makes an audience have an enhanced experience of having a performer at close quarters? There's one experience of my being able to look into the eyes of an audience member who is sitting 6 feet away from me or 20 feet away from me. And there is a rasa that gets created there. Now, that rasa is not going to be created. So I have to find another rasa using technology differently to be able to create that experience. So what can I do to show the audience something that they won't see in a live performance? You know, so it's a whole other thinking. But even to do that, Mithali, we need a year of financial support to be able to think this through. We can't have a sort of gun here, not knowing where salaries are going to be paid from, and then try and think creatively. We need to create an R&D department in our heads and with our colleagues to be able to do the R&D. And R&D is not something that you can do in a time frame. And that is really what the crucial question is.
You raise a very important point, and I am going to come to that, you know, about creating some kind of security net for the community. But on your point about online content, that is extremely important as well. A, how do you think, you know, what do you think the after effects will be of this kind of sort of bombardment of online content for the performing community? And second, do you fear that to some level it sort of disregards or lowers the importance of financial remuneration for a performance artist? Because I think that is a very important part, which is, you know, often scoffed at or often said, you know, you're in the art, you shouldn't worry about money, which is nonsense.
Of course it's nonsense. And yes, the other problem that you haven't mentioned is the abysmal quality of very much of the content that is going online just now. I mean, anybody and everybody is putting really bad content, and the superb content gets lost in the flurry of what is coming through. Listen, the arts are a profession like anything else. And for most people, it is what runs their families. Yeah. Delhi, to a great extent, the government and the embassies and other organizations was already making it difficult for artists to demand a fee because they wanted to give everything for free. In Delhi, to get somebody to actually pay and buy a ticket was very, very difficult because so much is on offer for free. So there was that feeling anyway. Oh, as an artist, you know, you love your work. Yeah, hello, we hope that the engineer also loves her work. or the doctor also loves her work, but the doctor still needs to be paid for it. And yes, I think if this flurry continues, unless we reinvent and give a very different performance or product or whatever you want to call it, we are going to lose audiences.
Help me walk through, for even someone watching this, Ms. Sarabhai, what the tangible cost damage is. I think people don't understand, you know, what kind of costs are incurred when you keep theaters shut for very long, when you have these large communities, as you said, because the problem for industries such as yours, and also for restaurants and tourism, for example, is that they may not be very large contributors to GDP, but they are extremely large caches of employment. There are a lot of people getting their annual income out of these little ecosystems. So, you know, give me a sense of what kind of losses the community is facing at this point.
So, for instance, Darpana is on several different counts. So, we are a performing group that goes out and performs. Okay, so that is one income. Because my mother started this organization so many years ago, and because at that stage, Papa's businesses were doing very well, and she decided that she never personally wanted to take any money out of Darpana. So whatever she earned as an artist went into Darpana. I have followed the same. So I have not taken it. So when I say my fees, it's actually fees that I generate that goes to support the organization. So that's one large cachet. The other cachet, which is smaller but important, is student fees. We have tried in Darpana to keep the student fees affordable for anybody, and even so give 100% scholarship. So that's another one. The third one is what Natrani, our venue, earns as support or membership fees or corporate members and brings in as ticket sales. So these are the three different revenue models we have. Yes, we have gone online with classes, but we have lost 50% of our students. That's obvious because, you know, most households have maybe one phone or two phones, and dancing is very low on people's priorities, which is sad, because dancing can actually alleviate depression and mental stress more than most things the arts can. But anyway, so it falls low on the scale. So we've got only 50% of our students on. Natrani is completely shut. I have 8 people on the payroll of Natrani, plus cleaners and so on. I have to keep that running. My performances, I don't know when we will be able to perform again. People are saying, okay, why don't you have this social distancing and start performances again? A, it's not yet allowed, but imagine this. If I'm social distancing, my ticket sales will be 1/3 because there'll be only 1/3 of the people there. Am I going to tell artists, please take 1/3 of your fee? Am I going to go to the airline and say, I'm sorry, I can only pay 1/3 of the ticket cost because I'm only getting 1/3 of the revenue? And you know, establishments like Darpana, it's a large organization. I have to have security people. I have to have people running the place. I can't let it run to the ground, which means that though I have let like 4 people go, I still have 28 people here. And with zero or minimal setup for the classes and so on, that just pays for the teacher's salary, if that. So where are the revenues coming from? Yeah. You know, India has always had an extremely bad structure for supporting the arts. Pandit Nehru started the Ministry of Culture, and there were like 10 organizations, Darpana included, which used to get support. But as the years have gone on, it's become less and less and less. Nobody replaced the temples and the Maharajas as supporters of the arts. The corporates have never understood the meaning of it. And with the general levels of corruption, nepotism, favoritism that have been on the increase, at least for the last 30, 35 years, the little money that the government gives goes to favorites. And now increasingly to those singers who are willing to feed into the right-wing agenda. So anybody who takes the basic of Hinduism and questions in their art are immediately shunted out. And I'm not talking of me, because I've been shunted out many years ago, but there are others who through their work question. And questioning is the basis of Vedantic philosophy, of the Upanishads. And questioning is the basis of the arts. Questioning, commenting on society has to be the basis of the arts. And yet that has gone. And nothing has replaced it. I think when Rajiv Gandhi started the zonal centers, at that time, 5 crores to each center seemed enormous to us. And yet the zonal centers have never done anything. They might have held a festival here and a festival there, but they've done nothing. You see, performance is just the public end of years and years of work. That's not the glamour. That is what needs support. It is the practicing every day. It is the working on new pieces every day. It's all of that that doesn't get financed, that nobody thinks needs to be financed. And yet, if that goes, and I'm not only talking of urban arts, I'm not talking of the classical arts, I'm talking of the amazing folk arts. I mean, all through the lockdown, I had Manganiyar friends phoning me and saying, hum 300 log hai, hamare paas kuch bhi nahi aaya. And luckily, I have enough contacts in Rajasthan who can contact the right people to get money there. But that's just one community. There are thousands of such communities, and they have never been funded. But they have had patrons who will call them to perform, so there's always this, which is gone. We need to completely differently think about this, and it can't be only the government. Mithali, if there's one thing that distinguishes India from any other country, it's us. It's the arts and the crafts, it's the craft that I'm wearing, it's the jewelry that I'm wearing, it's the language that we speak, it's the cuisine. Nothing else. We'll never have better roads than the rest of the world. We'll never have bigger aeroplanes than the rest of the world. And even if we do, so what? So if this goes,
on that point that you raise about a lack of government support, it's not like examples don't exist. I mean, a couple of weeks back, the UK government announced a very large-sized £1.57 billion system for the arts that included, you know, faster access to loans, emergency grants. How hopeful are you that state governments or the central government will consider something like this?
And even if it happens, it will be the same nepotism, the same favoritism, and the same corruption. I have absolutely no hope.
That's a system.
That is not the way our government thinks. The state government, Gujarat government has not. Gujarat government hasn't had a Department of Culture for 30 years.
And over the last
couple say that again?
Yeah, over the last couple of years, Mallika, this is a systematic process you've seen of funds being sort of altered and turned to move into a more narrow basket that checks the boxes the government desires.
Absolutely. No question about that.
You know, it's not just the performing community also, Mallika. You know, as you said, it's people who work in schools, people who work perhaps with restaurants, hotels. You know, what is your sense of how the performing arts community will come out of this? Will people just have to abandon a skill that they have learned over so many painstaking years and have to switch to something else?
You know, Mithali, for most performers, their primary income has never been generated from the arts. They've always had to do other things everywhere in the world. Whether it's waiting tables in New York or whether it's teaching here. Here, teaching has been a very strong source of fallback income for the arts. Whether it's teaching in schools, whether it's 5 little girls from the neighboring community coming to my house and me doing tuku-tuku-tuku-tuku and they learning or whatever. Good, bad, indifferent, doesn't matter. I think that will take a big fall. Because parents have to readjust their priorities. And 99.9% of children who actually learn the arts don't become artists. They imbibe amazing things because of that process of training. I constantly have people across the world coming to me and said, you know, we are a student of Darpanas, we did the 7 years. We've never danced since, but that training and what we went through has kept us through every crisis. And that for me is a very important value of the arts. we are trying to run a project in Ahmedabad's municipal schools. We ran it very successfully last year. And it was a project to try different things. One was, how do you get the children to have a better sense of the body when the body is seen as shameful in India? And that shame leads to so many issues and so many complexes. Second is, how do you teach them something that will liberate not only the body, but because the body is liberated, will liberate the mind? And the third was, how do we get them to understand more about cultures that are different from them, but still very much part of India? So we started this project teaching them folk dancing, but through folk dancing, telling them about a community from the Northeast, for instance, or a community from Orissa, and getting them to learn about that community and getting them to understand that this is also India. And the change that we saw in these children, all from the slums, was astonishing. Just the way they stood at the end of 8 months of training, just the way they looked into our eyes and talked. Now, this is also a very important part of arts education, whether it's paintings so that you can paint things that you don't want to talk about, or it is this sense of self, sense of strength, sense of concentration that it develops. And that's going to take a huge fall because face-to-face interaction is not going to be possible, and because the phone or the tablet is going to be used for more useful things.
You're bang on, and I cannot stress enough, even from a sort of, you know, personal life story, how important the performing arts have been, especially when in India we tend to push children down the silos of academic performance and percentiles. You find your own self outside of that. You know, some entrepreneurs that I've spoken with in the past, Ms. Sarabhai, have made the point that it's darkest before dawn. Maybe this is our opportunity to emerge from this in a much stronger light. And, you know,
I think the dawn will come post us.
If at all.
I'm sure that.
I want your sense on whether you think at this point now, people will really give a deep thing to the value of creating some kind of social system for performance artists, something which is more tangible, which is more community-based, where there is monetary support, of course, but also this kind of emotional support that is important through crises such as these.
I can hope. I'm an optimist. I can hope that suddenly people will find their humanity and humility and understand understand what really counts in life, what really counts. I hope. And forget about buying Gucci bags by flying to Paris for an afternoon.
And what do we have if we don't have hope? My final question to you, you know, I turn back to the speech that you intended to give the class of 2020.
NID.
Yeah, NID. And you talked about unemployment, you talked about divisiveness, you talked about expansion at the cost of environment. All that, at this point, it seems, has been exacerbated. When you look to the future, how are you feeling?
From what I read, at least some CEOs and chairs of company seem to be looking at a very different kind of business model. In other countries, more so than in India, but I'm sure it will happen in India as well. We need to reinvent society, not just one sector. We need to understand that we are a very small cog in a much larger wheel. We need to re-understand the definition of success. We need to throw out the concept of the GDP because it means nothing. There's a whole churning that will necessitate the changing of everything that we have over the last 30 years in the neo-capitalist world put on top of the success pyramid. If I don't know whether my being in the same room is going to kill me, does it really matter if I have 75 houses? And will that person who otherwise wanted 75 houses realize this and realize the immediacy and the unnecessariness of so much that we have kept dear to us? We need to understand what relationships mean, what being in the same room means when you can't even hug. I mean, I saw this wonder. I'm a dog person. I saw this wonderful cartoon of three dogs looking at a group of people all with muzzles and saying, "Oh, now they've adopted them themselves." So it's a bit like that. It's a bit like that. You know, I think this is a moment of reckoning, and I just hope that with the tragedies that we have seen unfolding around us, I would like to ask, for instance, real estate barons, whether they feel even as their own profit, that looking after workers and seeing that they are safe and well and fed is important or not. I want to ask entrepreneurs where their workers come from, how sanitary and how healthy that environment is, because that one worker could kill you. So does it make you think differently, even out of selfishness? Will you be more generous? Even out of self-interest, will we think differently? Will we think differently of the people who sweep the streets? What would happen if the streets weren't swept? And yet, yesterday, 5 people died in a manhole in Ahmedabad. So we can just hope, but what is needed is a complete rethink of everything that we think we know, from the most primary to the most tertiary.
Indeed. And I hope that for people listening, if this even sparks off that catalyst of thought in a few people, it would have been a beginning indeed. I so appreciate your time today. It's been absolutely wonderful speaking with you. Thank you for joining in and speaking with me.
Thank you.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.